Barstool, today's his birthday. First issue ever of Barstool Sports. So Mark J. Burns tweeted this. On August 27th, 2003, Barstool Sports and Sue Presidente released the company's first newspaper issue. 17 years later, Barstool Sports is valued at $450 million after Penn National acquired 36% for $163 million in cash stock in 2020. To say that we're valued at $450 million right now is wildly inaccurate. Let's start with that. We were valued at $450 million. We're closer to probably $4.5 billion now. When we did this deal, we got one offer. People are afraid of our reputation. And they're like, oh, how's Wall Street going to react? And FanDuel, DraftKings, PointsBet, Stars, MGM all dragged their feet. All dragged their feet. Didn't even make an offer. Probably could have had us for cheaper, to be totally honest. Penn, Jay Snowden had the nuts. And I told everybody. I sat in meetings. I said, if you don't do this deal, you're going to regret it. People are going to look at you, CEO of FanDuel, CEO of whoever, going to be, why didn't you do this deal? And they're not going to have an answer. And I'm going to make everyone regret it, just like I did with the Churn deal. I said it to people's faces. And now I would preface it, be like, I'm biased. It's my company. But when people look back at this deal, they're going to be like, that was the greatest deal ever. Like, we bought them for pennies on the dollars. So why didn't we sell for more? Because we didn't have any other offers. We named our price with Penn, and they did it. Credit to Penn. But I know us, and I know despite the noise that sometimes surrounds us, people fucking love us, and we're a fucking beast. I knew that. So $450 million, we're not valued at $400. We're closer to $4.5 billion now. Have you seen what we've done? Have you seen now? I don't like to like toot my own horn because sometimes the horn wears out. I'm the most influential person in this space by a fucking landslide. I'm a cult leader and companies that are super successful. Hey, Elon Musk up fucking another four. You need the guy. You need the guy that's like, that's the guy. He's not going anywhere. Love him, hater. He's going to fucking drag people to the finish line. I'm going to take fucking woke Nate by a wedgie and fucking throw his ass across the bench. Who else can make something out of Nate? Nobody. I don't even fucking like the kid. In 2003, Portnoy had a crummy sales job, wanted to start a free newspaper. True. A sum of money from his parents, about 25 grand my parents gave me to help with the racks. It would have been graduate school money. That's true. It would have been a year of grad school. Helped them buy about 100 news racks. True. So about 100 news racks, 80 bucks each. It was like 25 grand. Spread them throughout various Boston metro stations. He and a small group of writers, including current blogger Jerry Thornton, wrote for free, though they had other jobs. The original four. Thornton, Pete Manzo. The return of Manzo is legendary. One of the greatest. I would say, I don't know what Pete Manzo's doing right now. But he's the best writer I've ever seen. I wish he stayed. Maybe he's a millionaire on his own. Who knows? He'd be a millionaire if he stayed. Whatever. And Chisholm, who I love. Same thing with him. Wish he stayed. I know he's doing well. Wrote about fantasy sports gambling under fake names to make the operation seem better. It's supposed to be gambling newspaper, gambling and picks. According to a local photographer, Eric Levin, that's who started taking pictures of the girls on our cover. Renee, my ex, obviously, helped get the girls. They were her friends in the beginning. That's how I met her. In a beat-up Astro van, Portnoy delivered the newspapers themselves. 48-hour paper route. I drove around the city of Boston 48 straight hours, picking shit out of news racks, fucking battling rabid fucking raccoons in the dumps. 48 hours. I just feed myself with fucking coffee. I used to have fucking cigars that I'd smoke. I drag race about Boston, in and out, did that for about 5 years. Later, he started working with local models to hand them out. That's reversed. I started with models. I started with models and then couldn't afford them and did it myself for like 5 years. I did models for like 2 or 3 weeks. So he remained confident in the early days where those people around Portnoy, like friend and ESPN analyst Todd McShay, who thought differently. So I lived with McShay in the beginning. McShay said I legitimately thought he was going to go bankrupt. I was worried about him. He just kept grinding. I had all this credit card debt, and I'd call the credit cards and just rearrange the debt. My mother would help me with that. In the mid-2000s, Barstool started appearing on local radio and diversifying revenue beyond ads, including selling T-shirts, staging events, parties, bringing their audience to bars. If you could drive traffic to bars, you could get money. I sold t-shirts from Newspaper One. We had these ugly shirts that said Barstool on them, and I hired fucking homeless people to hand out the newspaper. They sucked, so I stuck with all the shirts and sold them. So I've sold the merch game has been my blood from day one. Also, the radio, that was the power hour. Me, Elio, and McShay. Paying 15-10 the zone. Chicago native Barstool Big Cat joined 2008, become one of the company's key figures. I didn't know what year Big Cat joined, but he has it kind of out of order. Because Big Cat, I tried to get Big Cat, and Big Cat wouldn't come on board. KFC, K Marco, and Smitty were all before Big Cat, and Tall Mo. In 2010, Barstool's business stretched to hosting college parties, the Blackout Tour. First, it was actually School of Palooza with Sam Adams. Then we went to the Blackout Tour, which was a DJ party, which ironically was Draft Street, which is the online fantasy company that was bought by DraftKings, is who had us start the Blackout Tour. Gained notoriety in the Northeast. It gained notoriety in the world. For good reasons, bad hospitalizations, overdose, the debauchery led to its elimination. I mean, it was an EDM party. We didn't have big, it was actually safer. We never had an OD. We never had hospitalizations. People drained too much. Every fucking concert in the world had it. We had less, but people didn't like it. It was a Portnoy, the party you did in your house, but it was in a professional venue. It had no rules. Meanwhile, Barstool expansion continued. Barstool still centered around the site. K Marco, KFC, Barstool joined with New York, Philly. Key market was Smitty with Barstool Nate heading up DMV. Trent joined. So he just has the order out. All those things were before Chicago. In May 15th, Portnoy and a group featuring Stool Sales Guy, Spikes, Barstool, Hank, Henny's all gained more publicity for the brand after the quartet was arrested at NFL headquarters. The group handcuffed themselves together, held a sit-in Deflategate protest the Brady Four. In January 2016, Churning Group invested $20 million to acquire 51% at 10 to 15 valuation. The valuation was $12.5 million. Their original offer was $7 million, which was wildly insulting, and I was insulted by it. And then it went up to 12.5, which, again, they got on the cheap, and people are always like, oh, Churning took advantage of you, Churning took for a ride. By the way, I made Churning, I think, 250 to 300 million themselves. They made 250 to 300. I am the guy from The Godfather. Dave Portnoy always makes his partners money. Nobody has made their partners more money over a longer track record at 100% success rate than me, and yet people still bet against me. They made 200. They cleared $250 million on a $12 million investment, and everyone's like, "Why did you fucking sell for that cheap?" I had one offer. This wasn't a competing offer. This was not anything. Barstool was at the breaking point, and I knew it. And we needed to reinvigorate everything. Guess what? That deal has made multimillionaires out of Big Cat, out of fucking Kevin, out of fucking a lot of people. Fucking Gaz. Everybody in that Milton office will be a Milton millionaire. Meanwhile, Saturday's boys was also born at 16, thanks to Barstool. He came up with a PFT commenter, was hired in March the same year to team up with Big Cat, beginning of the woke side of Barstool. Barstool hired digital media executive Eric Nardini as its CEO in July 2016. Barstool had fewer than 15 people at the time. Nardini, Colby College alumni who previously spent time at AOL, Microsoft, among others, beat out 74 male candidates for the top business role. And I don't even know if that's saying it correctly, because she wasn't trying to be hired. Churning Group hired a very high-powered recruiting firm, and their job was to find a CEO. So my first thing when I moved to New York, I met with about 70 men. I didn't like any of them. None of them made it to the second role. All of them sucked. All of them had the wrong messaging. I'm like, nope, nope, nope. We actually had a lady, Betsy Morgan, who was an advisor. She's a Nantucket local woman, used to be the CEO of Huffington Post, and she was like an advisor, our first and only advisor, really, for Barstool. And she was in town near where I lived, and she's like, want to grab a coffee? I was like, yeah, sure, I'll grab coffee. Went to coffee with her, and she was friends with Erica, who just happened to be there. And Erica and I just started talking, and Erica's like, oh, yeah, I like Barstool. I'm a fan of Barstool. And her and I hit it off. After that coffee meeting, I called Churning and I was like, hey, have you guys ever heard of Erica Nardini? And they're like, yeah, we love her. Why? What's up? I'm like, I just met her and I think she should be our CEO. That started the process of us courting Erica. I went out to dinner with Erica. I think I had a wine spritzer and she had like a whiskey or something. And we hit it off. Then she proceeded to meet all of our guys. We went to some Chinese food restaurant and all of our guys, it was like Kevin, Dan, K. Marco, and they just bickered like little cats, little mice. And I'm sitting there being like, we're trying to get this woman to be our CEO and you guys are fucking being absolute assholes. I'll never forget that fucking dinner. Long story short, we were able to get Erica to come on board and it's the best hire we've ever made. And I resent, and she should resent, and every female should resent. People are like, oh, it's just a beer. It had nothing to do with that. If Erica was a man and I happened to meet her and hit it off the same way, a man would be our CEO. Nardini, already a fan of Barstool, walking on the company, had a history of racist, sexist, misogynic behavior and content. I don't really, I reject all of that. We're a comedy site. There are issues that continue to plague the company. Not really, they do, but I mean, you can't fucking say boo in today's society. It's elevated sensitivities, elevated fucking everything. And we're just trying to make people laugh. Her mandate was to bring structure, business acumen to a company that never truly had a CEO as well. I mean, I was kind of CEO. I was just doing a lot of fucking things. As grow revenue, diversify the portfolio, broaden the brand. 2017 distribution across digital TV were key areas, experimentation while e-commerce became a focus. Again, e-commerce was always focused, but Erica's fucking murdered it. Leading to the Super Bowl that year, the company's regular rundown aired from Houston on Comedy Central. That was probably when tensions were highest. Big Cat fucking hated me. I hated Big Cat during that time. There's a lot of PMT stuff. That was not a friendly time to be just people. That was as strenuous a relationship as we've ever had. Later that fall, Barstool and Facebook partnered around a live on-campus college football show. They both mutually agreed to part ways after six episodes. Facebook was just total morons. Facebook literally didn't know what the hell they were fucking talking about. So fucking dumb. Both the Facebook ESPN relationships were important learnings in Nardini's early tenure. I'd say our tenure is like, fuck ESPN, fuck Facebook. They're never going to get comfortable with us. They just want our audience. Fuck them. Under his leadership in 2017, Barstool acquired Her Relationship Rough and Rowdy amateur boxing contest. Months later, launched his own channel on SiriusXM, a deal that legitimized the company even more. In the past 2 years, Barstool has reverted back to his gambling roots, hiring the likes of Brand Walker, Marty Mush, podcast video franchises, the creation of Coach Doug's out-of-box ideas always been in the core DNA of Barstool. So we've gone from 15 people to 250 people. Our sportsbook app launches in September. Big name talent like Pat McAfee, Rappaport, Jenna Marbles. Rappaport, big name talent? I think not. Among others, have come at Dion, have come and gone. Yet to a large extent, the core has remained steady over the past decade. And it's true. The original fucking names and faces. Podcasts, Call It Daddy, Part of My Take, Chicks in the Office, Spit and Chicklets, Foreplay, among the most popular. We've added Alex Cooper, Gilly the Kid, Wallow, recently Deion Sanders. At the time of Penn's investment, its stock was less than 30. It's now over 55. Said Churnin's Mike Kearns on firm's Barstool Investment. We had low end and a high end of what would happen. It's already blown past every scenario on the high end. It was a once in a lifetime investment. And that's the fucking story of Barstool as told by a 40-point thread on our birthday. I'll also say I saw some like Goldman Sachs or somebody thing. As we move to the future, we haven't even fucking started here. I'm up 140 grand, by the way. Say that he thinks the Penn National deal with Barstool will go down as possibly the greatest transaction of all time. The greatest bargain of all time. I don't love always being on the receiving end of like, oh my God, Dave, you sold for like the biggest bargain of all time. You got taken to the cleaners. I can't stress this enough. There were no other offers. Nobody, FanDuel didn't make an offer. DraftKings didn't make an offer. MGM didn't make an offer. We met with them all. We had a banker group that's supposedly the best in the gambling space. They couldn't get one offer. Some people said it's because of me. They're like, Dave's too volatile. Nobody will take a chance on him. They don't think it can work. Like, companies are afraid of Dave. Two companies have taken a chance on me. Two. Churnin Group, Penn National. I made 250 quarter millies out of Churnin. I make billionaires on top of billionaires out of fucking Penn. Just the beginning. I love the doubt. I love the hate. It fucking feeds me.